G'day, I'm Michaela Boland, and today on The Filter, we're talking the Weinstein effect in Australia's local industry.
Now to the latest on Harvey Weinstein.
He's being accused of sexually harassing actresses.
The number of Hollywood actresses coming forward continues to grow.
The sexual assault allegations against Hollywood film producer Harvey Weinstein and the flood of accusations that's followed in the US are well publicised. Well, last week, the issue washed up on our shores, with dozens of actresses, most prominently Anna McGann, revealing the problem is rife in the local stage and screen industries. Joining me to discuss this situation is Liz Doran, screenwriter of numerous TV series, including Please Like Me, Molly, and Dance Academy, TV producer Nick Murray, who makes shows like Gruen, Go Back to Where You Came From, and Bondi Rescue, and Actors Equity director Zoe Angus.
What I'm really curious about is why this story has such a pointy head in the US, that is, it's the Harvey Weinstein scandal, but in Australia, we don't really have a name for it. You know, Anna McGann, an actress who is a victim, is one of the few people who've put their name to it. Zoe, why do you think that's the case?
Well, I certainly think there's a culture of not wanting to talk about it. The reality of an actor's life is it's freelance, it's short-term project, you're only as good as your last job. That means a really precarious employment relationship, and it's very difficult for people to confidently call an unpleasant situation for fear of causing trouble.
We've seen some really, really powerful stories coming out in the last few days of people through theatre and the screen industries, behind the scenes, on stage, on screen. Are we going to see names put to those, or is this a moment and then it's all going to go away?
Well, there are a couple of things going on. Tracy Spicer has put a call out for people to report instances, and she's gathering data and gathering stories. The other thing that's occurring is before the Weinstein story blew, Equity initiated our own survey about sexual harassment in live performance, because that's where we were hearing, anecdotally, recurring reports of problems. And we've had a significant increase in the number of people since the Weinstein story blew completing our survey. And so what we are seeing is that some 40 to 60% of respondents have a first-hand experience of sexual harassment, and somewhere between 10 to 18% are reporting actual criminal first-hand experiences.
Liz, you're a scriptwriter, so I guess you wouldn't imagine that this goes on in the story room.
The interesting thing I think about our industry, when you're making stories and you're being creative, I'm not talking about harassment, because I think that's a clear message of consent and power and all those kind of things, but the kind of conversations that you have in a story room can often be bawdy and silly, and often you make sort of inappropriate jokes in order to tell a particular story or to kind of just get a laugh in a room so that then someone will tell a different kind of a story, you know? And it's an interesting thing about people feeling kind of afraid to be open in a creative way.
Is that what you're saying is the case now?
I'm saying it's a potential. I think it's a potential problem.
Would you say that, Nick? I mean, you've produced comedies. Do you think that the story room has to have that sort of that looseness to it in order to create that comedy gold?
Yeah, I mean, I certainly wouldn't be encouraging, something that amounted to harassment. But if some of the definitions of harassment would be touched upon by talking about a lewd story in front of someone of the opposite sex, that technically is sexual harassment. So from that point of view, you need that sort of needs to be put to one side in certain creative environments. In the writer's room, for instance, if you're trying to write a story that needs some of those things, you want people to bring their own personal experiences to it and tell those stories. Because our industry is full of risk takers. I mean, you want them to be involved in discussions which might, in other places, if you're working in a bank, might step over the line. You asked before about why, it's the Weinstein thing in Hollywood, and it's not, hasn't got some name other than that here. I think there is a difference here in that we don't quite have some of those power power imbalances, you know, where someone who absolutely can wreck your career.
So the studios are, on the one hand, they're really powerful, but then here in theatre, you do have a series of very powerful companies that you know, actors work between. But in the screen industry, you've got a lot of little companies.
Yeah, I think that makes the situation really tricky. That essentially what we are is an industry of freelancers who work for a series of small companies, yeah. Often, like, I'm currently working for three different companies at once in a freelance capacity. Those sort of workplace frameworks, you know, those sort of sexual harassment rules and regulations are really tricky in an industry where you don't really have a workplace, or you have a set, you know, or you have a show, but you only have that for a couple of months and then you go on to a new one.
But you, Liz, your first encounter with sexual harassment in this industry was way before you'd even joined the industry.
Right, well, there was an interesting thing. I found that Me Too thing really interesting. My first reaction to it was, oh, well, I've never been sexually assaulted. And it took me a couple of days of reading other women's kind of Me Toos to kind of go, actually, I am going to contribute to this Me Too, because even though what I've had, I would consider kind of low-level sexual harassment rather than assault, it still has impacted on my relationship to work. And this is, like, I hasten to say, it's a tiny little story. When I went for, in the olden days when you went to the film school, they used to get you to come and do a whole day of interviews. And I was like a total newbie. And also really excited about going to film school. Like, the idea of that I would get into this national film school was like, this was my dream at that point. And one of the people who had to interview me was an old dinosaur, since passed away, but an old dinosaur. And so I walked into his office and the first thing he said to me was, you're much better looking than this photograph on your application. And this is what I'm saying, so it's very low level.
And you weren't going for, it wasn't an acting job you were going for,
no, this
right?
is like to apply to be an editor at the film right. school.
Where looks are no part whatsoever.
Really not important. I immediately was thrown. I had this thing of like, wait, is this part of the interview? What does this mean? Am I supposed to be flirting with you? Like, I don't want to flirt with you. I'm here to do, like, I'm here for an interview. And I think that's often what happens to women. There's this layer on the work that you have, this extra sort of thinking that you have to do. And it's this extra kind of like, what do I have to do to get out of this situation? How can I get out of this situation without not annoying this man who actually I really want to impress, because I really need something from him in this situation. I want to get into film school.
But right before your career has even started, it sets a certain tone for right. how you might have to behave with somebody senior in the industry.
And why this is a watershed moment for us, why this is a really important time, is now, now it's not a private individual matter. You know, now, because of the blowing of the Weinstein story, it is repeated, recurring. We're hearing a real sense of, now this is a public, broad phenomenon that you can't look away from anymore. And I think there's a difficult thing that we need to grapple with in our industry, and that is the potential dysfunction of the creative process itself, where you have a situation of ongoing intimacy and trust that breaks down into a dysfunctional, dangerous and harmful situation between parties. I think there's a real sense historically and culturally that employers' responsibility will be parked at the creative gate. And that what occurs in the creative process is for those participants to sort out themselves. There needs to be proactive steps by employers as part of their duty of care to engage with what are the foreseeable risks within the creative process itself and take proactive steps to address that.
That does happen in certain parts of the production industry. So people who are involved in making reality shows, there are quite significant risk assessments to protect and look after the well-being of the people working on those shows. But I think you're right, that doesn't happen on a drama or
But I wonder whether the difference between screen drama, say, and the theatre is that rehearsal process. For instance, let's just take a sex scene in a dramatic production. That is usually a very unsexy environment where all those, you know, it's off a script, everything's broken down into shots and the set is usually cleared, you know, and there's all these sort of rules and regulations around those kinds of scenes. And obviously they're not always foolproof. But like, I sort of feel like in the theatre, because you do these days and weeks of rehearsal, it's this sort of very physical process, particularly between the actors. I feel like that is a kind of environment where those moments can be really blurred.
Well, that's certainly the case. There are particular vulnerabilities in live performance. I think there's the traditional presumption that the rehearsal space is closed to the, you know, the employer obligations, if you like. If you're doing, you know, a sex or a violence scene 8 times a week for many, many weeks, then there are, you know, there are emotional hazards that are entirely foreseeable and therefore need to, you know, be addressed.
On that note, thank you so much for coming together, and I really look forward actually to seeing how this is going to play out in the weeks to come, now that these stories are on the table, the policies and the changes in the industry that flow from them. Thanks.
You're so overpriced.